Audio presents Little Miss Little Compton, written and read by Arden Myrin. Hello, everybody. This is Arden Myrin. Thank you for buying my audiobook. Guys, I'm going to be real with you. Times are a little crazy right now. It's 2020. The date is September 13th, 2020. And I don't know if you guys have read the news or not, but things are not normal this year. Normally, I would be in some snazzy recording studio that my publisher had set up, and it would sound pro. As it is, I'm in my garage that has been turned into a recording studio, and it's pretty cute, I'm not gonna lie. Not that you can see it, but just picture me in a room covered in elephant fabric, and I'm doing my best reading into my podcast microphone, and I know you're like, girl, I spent $11 on this audiobook. I wanted pro quality. I'm doing my best. We're all doing our best. I'm rooting for you. I hope you're rooting for me. I hope it sounds okay. Here we go. Get ready. It's quite a ride. For my sweet mama bear, I love you and I miss you so much. All the world is made of faith and trust and pixie dust. Peter Pan. I'm going to read the foreword by my magical friend Debbie Ryan from Insatiable and Jesse and my friendship. I wish I had a sultry voice like her, so just picture this in a voice about 18 octaves lower than my own. Foreword
by Debby Ryan.
When my friend and yours, Arden Myrin, asked me to write the foreword for her book, I cried in her passenger seat. And then we went and got tacos. Arden has told me so many wild stories from her life, each one more hilarious and bizarre than the last, and I figured I must have heard them all by now. Not true. This book is filled with even more new gems than I could have expected. If I didn't know Arden, I probably wouldn't believe a lot of what's in these pages, but it's too specific, too bananas, and too canonically Arden to be made up. That's right, Debby Ryan wrote canonically. I've never even used that word. I didn't even know how to pronounce it. Get it, Debby Ryan. You go, girl. I've never known such a gorgeous tornado of a soul with an even larger hurricane swirling in different forms around her life. I can't tell whether Arden has a distinctly funny perspective or just attracts ridiculous things. I consider hangouts with Arden my ab day because the laughter is always side-splitting. It's also a sort of therapy because the conversation is self-aware and challenges me to think about things in a new way. I spent a lot of time in Arden's passenger seat. Spending time with Arden really makes you start to see the funny in everything. In the time it takes to get to and from a shitty taco joint, we've usually started 40 different conversations and finished 4. We've been stared at by strangers and disturbed the peace. I've been blindsided by the iron fist of wisdom in the velvet glove of laughter. That's Arden. I'm excited this book exists so that you can get to know her as I have. Thanks, Debby. That's really nice. She wrote that. How nice is that? When I arranged a private twerk out class in a Hasidic rec center, I never could have imagined it would be the place where my friend would hear some of the worst news of her life. Arden and I had been getting closer, and in many ways, she had scooped me into her passenger seat, and I've watched her follow her path. That day, I got in the driver's seat and came to care about Arden on our trip to Grief Island in a way I'd never anticipated. Arden's sense of humor courses through her and is present in every way. The absurd nature of her personality lets you know why she is the way she is. I've been told that God doesn't waste pain, and I've seen firsthand the beauty and comedy Arden was able to find even during the shadows of tragedy. Arden has taught me that it's okay to feel like you're way too much and not enough at the same time. She taught me how to identify the things you come by honestly. She's held my hand and taught me to listen for the difference between my little monster voices and the ones that actually want to help me. She showed me how to turn my damage into superpowers and take the control back from the unproductive things. She didn't teach me not to date the drummer. I've learned by watching Arden navigate heartbreak that my biggest fear could come true, but that I could still put myself back together. I've learned about the power of holding my own and allowing myself to have a delayed reaction. I've seen the importance of play, of spending time with people who make me feel good, and tacos. Arden's mom, JJ, who you'll come to know through Arden's book, nicknamed me the Pistol. And Pistol, see Pistol. You see, the special thing about the difficult timing of the story is that you can see fingerprints from JJ's jazz hands in the big lessons. You'll learn to protect your magic and to start building your own boat. You'll realize that if you look for them, you will see fireflies. I hope you enjoy this book and love the journey. It's a whole riot. It's hard to believe and impossible to doubt. Go on the ride and don't be a drip. Introduction. It all started with my grandparents, the founding members of the Hasty Decisions Club. On January 26, 1937, in Philadelphia, a young businessman named Lars Myrin met a woman named Helen Lotta. He thought she was pretty and fun. She thought he was rich. One day later, they got married in Elkton, Maryland, because he didn't need a blood test to get hitched to Maryland. Five kids and five grandchildren later, my grandparents were married until the day they died, so it kind of worked out. My parents, Janet and Willie, not only joined the Hasty Decisions Club, they bumped it up a notch. They married on a dare, and they weren't even dating. It's as if some Rubenesque, non-musical Keith Richards decided to play marital chicken with Doris Day with one too many rosés in her. Willie Myrin met Janet Olson when they were co-workers on Wall Street. Willie was a party boy. Think John Belushi, but not as healthy. He was the second of five children, the wild child who gave himself nicotine poisoning when he snuck behind a shed and smoked an entire pack of Camels Unfiltered in the third grade. Janet Olson didn't stand a chance against that bad boy. The cute girl in the office on Wall Street, Janet wore white gloves to work and would take the Long Island Railroad into Manhattan every day from her parents' Leave It to Beaver-style household in Queens. She was the adorable secretary with the great gams whose boss would chase her around the desk every day, Mad Men style. A practical girl, Janet nonetheless enjoyed a party and was up for a good time. She found that, and much more, in Willie Myrin. The dare came about one night when Janet and Willie were having a few too many cocktails with co-workers after a day at the office and were trying to figure out how to wrangle the maximum amount of vacation time out of their employer. All employees got 2 weeks off a year, but if you went on a honeymoon, you got an extra 2 weeks. My father then did the kind of math that only a drunk accountant could come up with. He offered to marry my mom so they could get the full four-week vacation. He would pay for them to go to South America for a month, and then they would come back to the States and get the marriage annulled. Keep in mind, they had never even kissed or been on a date with each other. Double dog dare. I am not surprised that my dad got married on a dare, but I am totally stunned that Janet did. Why did she do it? No one could fully understand her reasoning, but I think it was a perfect storm of factors. Having recently been dumped by her college boyfriend, Janet's guard was down. And at 22, she was worried she was becoming an old maid. Ugh, how times have changed. Another unquantifiable thing was that my dad was wild and could be very fun. Let's be honest, it can be hard to resist a bad boy. It was also a snowy, magical New York City night. Janet took the leap. She accepted his dare. My parents couldn't find a Bible to swear on, so they swore on a cookbook. The next day, my mom called my dad and raised the ante. She told him she would do it, but if they got married, she didn't want to get their marriage annulled. Checkmate. 6 weeks later, they married at a country club in Long Island, my mother borrowing the wedding dress from her best friend Arden, my namesake. At the wedding, Willie's brother, Bertie, tried to persuade my father to jump out the dormer window in the men's bathroom, that it wasn't too late to escape, but Willie stuck to his dare. White as a ghost and sweating buckets, he stumbled down the aisle. Janet officially became Myrin. I know, there's a Y in it. But guys, guess what? It's pronounced Myrin, as in the few, the proud, the Myrins. But without the honor or the duty. It's a drunk Swedish Viking name. Don't ask me. After they got back from a whirlwind honeymoon, Willie told Janet that he would only live in one of two places, Manhattan or Little Compton, Rhode Island, where he had spent summers as a kid. Janet rolled the dice and chose the road less traveled, Little Compton, which has nothing in common with the California Compton. While the California Compton has produced such cultural heavyweights as N.W.A., Kendrick Lamar, Dr. Dre, The Game, and the album and film Straight Outta Compton, Little Compton's most famous resident is Poe the Crow, a bird that was on house arrest for stealing people's mail. In a tiny country farm town, there is a real live-and-let-live quality to life. In other words, you can get really weird and set up your own independent nation on your property, and no one will even question it. That's how Janet and Willie made a home governed by their own unique set of rules for life. 1 year later, my brother Alaric, no relation to the Visigoth Alaric, was born, followed by moi, 3.5 years later. I was born in the middle of a blizzard. When Willie came to meet me for the first time at the hospital, no dads in the delivery room for Janet Myrin, he did not come bearing flowers. Instead, he came with what every good woman who had just pushed out a 7-pound, 7-ounce butterball turkey really craves, a 12-pack of Drake's Devil Dogs. Upon meeting me, Willie declared, "She's not a blonde, she's a redhead. I never met a redheaded woman I trusted." And so began my wild ride with the Myrin family. Did my parents seem like an odd fit for each other? Sure. But my brother and I just figured they fell in love at work like many couples do. We didn't find out about the dare until it slipped out one day when we were teenagers. My brother, having never had a girlfriend in his life, came home from his freshman year in college with his first lady, an older woman. She was 20, who was a soprano with perfect pitch. She would wince when I sang, plugging her ears. Didn't she realize I was secretly Mariah Carey? They would go off to camps or where they would practice square dancing and learn to sing madrigals while men in tights played on the mandolin. Alaric was glassy-eyed from having sex for the first time. Who was this witchy woman and what had she done with my big brother? But her arrival was crucial to explaining a key part of who I was. She was chatting with my mother one day when we were all in the car. "Janet, how did you and Willie get engaged?" "Oh, it was stupid. We married on a dare." And that's when it all came out. We'd had no idea. My brother freaked out. "I'm sorry, what?" But to me, it was the moment of enlightenment. Oh, that explains everything. We didn't live like a normal family because we didn't start out like a normal family. I am the result of not one, but two hasty decisions. And it was those hasty decisions that were the foundation for a unique set of life rules that could only have come about when these two people went off the grid with their lifestyle choices. Growing up in my house was fun, warm, and inspiring, but also confusing. The one constant was that the most conventional rules were ignored. Marital courtship, bedtime. We were a house filled with night prowlers who stayed up into the wee hours even when I was in fifth grade. Pants. My dad wore nothing but boxers. The food pyramid. He ate nothing but cake. Social norms. My mom would take me and my brother to school at 10 a.m. because she felt like it wasn't fair to her night owl offspring to make them get up so early, and so on. While it was a wild tale, my unusual upbringing gave me a unique set of tools. My mom encouraged creativity, shooting for the stars, making things, and being scrappy. From my mom, I learned that if I stayed true to myself, protected what was unique about me, and worked hard enough, wonderful things would be in store. I wouldn't have.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.